We are about to begin our session titled Preparing the Citizens of Tomorrow. Are we succeeding or failing? A critique of education in Pakistan. Our moderator for this session is Fasi Zaka. Fasi Zaka is a Pakistani television host, columnist, and political commentator. He is co-host of the political commentary program Do Rai on Dawn News. I would request Fasi Zaka Saab to come on stage, please. Okay, I would request the speakers, the panelists as well to come on stage. Shahnaz Wazir Ali, Nadia Naviwala, Shahid Siddiqui, and Ishrat Husain to join Fasi Zaka on stage, please.
So hello everyone, and thank you for attending this session. This is Preparing the Citizens of Tomorrow. Are we succeeding or failing? We're going to look into a critique of the current education system in Pakistan. One of the things is that we have a very distinguished panel, and generally with distinguished panels, it takes a long time to introduce them. So I will try and summarize. You will know many of these people already. So I have with me Shahnaz Wazir Ali. She's been with the World Bank in the past. She's seen education reform up close. She's been elected. She's been a special assistant to the Prime Minister. She runs a group of schools under the Nasra Trust and has also worked in the past with the Pakistan Center for Philanthropy. And we have with us Nadia Naviwala. She's an expert in foreign aid, education reforms. She's currently a Wilson Center Global Fellow. She's also been a country representative for the U.S. Institute of Peace. And she's done a lot of work. You must have seen some of her recent journalism, long-form pieces on education, the impact of aid, and how it's being utilized in the country. To my extreme left, I have Dr. Shahid Siddiqui, who's currently the Vice Chancellor of Allama Iqbal Open University. He's been a professor at the Lahore School of Economics. He's been at LUMS. He has a PhD in applied linguistics from the University of Toronto. And he's got a number of books and a recent one on education reform and experience in Pakistan. It's really good. I'm sure it's available. I'd encourage most of you to read it. I have with me also Dr. Ishrat Husain. He's currently a public policy fellow at the Woodrow Wilson Center in Washington, D.C., professor emeritus at IBA. The Center of Excellence in Islamic Finance. He's been a dean and ex-director at the Institute of Business Administration, where it expanded significantly. There was a lot of reform, very positive reform. It's always been a great school, but it's been taken to another level of greatness. He's worked before that with the World Bank, worked extensively with the government as well, and you'd all also know him as a former governor of the State Bank of Pakistan. So I'd like to thank all the panelists for being here today. Just quickly, I'd like to open up how we intend to do this session. We're going to break it into three parts. We're going to do a first 20 minutes, which is essentially building context, talking about things most people are somewhat familiar with, which is the education system as it is. The next 20 minutes, we'll be talking about what do we really need for this coming century. In the last 20 minutes, we'll open up the floor to questions from the audience. I've already requested my panelists. We're going to cycle through things quite quickly. And so I'm going to open up with just a very general question. And I'd like to ask Shahnaz if you could answer this. Is you've had more than three decades of experience in education. Is the education debate or the degree of seriousness or the priority that it's been given by governments evolved significantly since you started off? You're gonna have to press that button.
If budgets are an indicator of commitment, yes, education sector budgets have increased. But I think the needle on education really hasn't moved much as far as government schools are concerned. because they have not really attended to what I think is a much, much more important indicator, which is what are students learning. So if there isn't sufficient priority on that still. There's a priority on expenditure of hardware, buildings, construction, etc. But the human resource development in terms of teacher, knowing their content and pedagogy, and the resource materials and learning materials in the classroom. So I would say that in society there is a priority, and I see that everywhere, from the remotest village of Balochistan to the central metropolis of Karachi and the huge expanding city of Lahore. But people are wanting education. They want to educate their girls and their sons. There's no doubt, daughters, there's no doubt about it, daughters and sons. But the schools are not offering relevant, meaningful, quality education. That's, to my mind, the central issue. So one can say that at a certain political level, there's a priority. The Act for the Right to Education has been passed. Provincial acts have also been passed. But the need to attend to classroom-based learning, quality learning, knowledge, and learning outcomes, that's still a very central deficit in the public sector system.
Okay. Nadia, I'd just like to ask maybe for one comment on the other big stakeholder, not just Pakistani parents and kids or the government, but it's also donors, especially over the past 10 years, we've seen an increasing commitment. What have donors gotten for this particular commitment?
It's very interesting, actually, because donors will have you believe that they are filling the financing gap as far as education is concerned, that where Pakistan is not spending, donors are. But it turns out that if you kind of look at the numbers, DFID's largest program in the world today is in Pakistan. We are the largest recipient of DFID money. Punjab is the largest program that they have, Punjab Education. But what DFID is giving Pakistan equals only 2% of what Pakistan spends. And despite this, there has been no change almost in the enrollment levels in Pakistan. It's pretty much stagnated. So to make a dent in this, we really have to talk about how Pakistan is spending its resources. Not, you know, DFID and even USAID, which was also 2% at its height. Today it's less than 1%, and they have a stand outside, which will have you believe that they are really making a difference in reading levels in this country. It's actually completely irrelevant to the progress in education in Pakistan.
Just a quick question, which is, then why is there this outsized impression that the donor is doing so much in education, or that, you know, whether it's funding, whether it's an impression of system change, this general belief, why does that exist?
In part, this baffles me as well. Sure, donors have created a kind of communications campaign out of the 1 or 2% that they're giving to Pakistan. But on the other hand, Pakistan also feeds into this narrative. Our government also feeds into this narrative by constantly saying that we need money, we don't have money, and nobody's paying attention to the fact that they've doubled their budget since 2010, and that our education budget now rivals, equals almost, our military budget. So no one's looking at the numbers, the government keeps asking for money, and I actually don't know why we think this. Because if you look at the data, it's very, very clear that the reality is not our narrative.
Okay. Dr. Siddiqui, if I could ask a quick question. Your expertise, your degree has also been in linguistics. Just a quick question on the thing that seems to come up again and again, and we've seen it with two provincial governments as well, which is the role of English, the role of Urdu, the role of the mother tongue. How important is it, especially in the early years, to create children who have a cognitive understanding of what they're learning from the language that they're using? So if you could just comment on that.
Thanks. I think language plays a very important part. We need to look at language not just as a tool of communication, but as an identity marker as well. And I agree with you that there are researches that support the fact that at initial level, education, mother tongue, is more meaningful. But I think in Pakistan, the question has been English or Urdu, and that's not how I look at it, because I believe that English as an international language is a need for our learners. And as far as Urdu and other languages are concerned, they are there for their own identity. So I look at the question of language not as, you know, you just leave one and take another, but we need to have additive approach that we keep our own languages, but we should be very open to learn English and other international languages. Yeah.
And Dr. Ishrat, I mean, you've had a lot of work in higher education. And is the higher education situation any different from how we find primary and secondary, or is the scale as big but the nature of the problem just different?
Thank you. There has been a quantitative expansion as far as tertiary education is concerned. And from a level of almost 200,000, we have now reached close to 1.8 million as far as the enrollment in the tertiary education is concerned. And there has been a proliferation of universities, both the private sector as well as the public sector. But if you contrast the 1960s, just Karachi University and Punjab University, the number of PhD faculty members was almost 50% of the total faculty. If you take today's situation, despite all this expansion, the entire faculty of the universities have only 25% PhD degrees. And that is the prerequisite. I'm not saying that PhD are good teachers, that's not the point, but that's the minimum qualification to become a university lecturer. So if you take that yardstick, we are way behind. We're actually falling behind. And this program, which was started in 2002, to send almost 10,000 faculty members for higher education across the world was discontinued in 2008, and that has created a setback. It's now being revived, but it will take some time. Even in the Fulbright scholarship program, which is the largest for the US, I have been a very vehement critic because they send our students to the second-rate universities and in subjects which are not relevant for Pakistan. So their employability and their usefulness to Pakistan's society, economy, is very, very limited. So yes, there has been a quantitative expansion. There are more universities. There are more students doing you know, masters and PhDs. And the university education is expanding. But the whole relevance of education to be of use to Pakistan's societal problems and economy is not actually moving in the right direction.
So I just ask Shahnaz another question is, given your experience in public policy, we saw that there was this great degree, a groundswell of hope around the 18th Amendment, that if the provinces had full control over education, they would actually be able to meet local needs better. What is the status of that sentiment? Is that sentiment holding? Has it been proven to be untrue, or is there just more time required?
Thank you, Fasi, for asking that question. I think we need to put some of these misperceptions at rest. Prior to the 18th Amendment, all of schooling, primary, middle, and secondary, and colleges rested with the provinces. The 18th Amendment has not made a significant difference to what happens in the schooling sector. Yes, it has brought about a very strong political commitment on an entitlement issue, which is the right to education. Now, somehow or the other there, people think that after the 18th Amendment, suddenly the provinces are going to do a much better job because of the 18th Amendment. That's really not the case. The provinces in any case determined their budgets for schools and for colleges. The federal government had really no say in it. And the recruitment of teachers, the placement of schools, the training of teachers, the textbook board publications, and everything else, monitoring, budgeting, and supervision, and field-based work, and the district infrastructure was always provincial, and provincially organized, and provincially controlled. I think maybe the national discourse has pointed a little bit more to the fact that this is an entitlements issue now, that every child has a right to education. So to my mind, the 18th Amendment has not made any significant difference to what happens in the education sector at the schooling level. But it certainly has opened up to a certain level a debate on what is happening about the rights of children. To that extent, yes, you have national fora and provincial fora, and these subjects are debated. But it is really, I think the landscape is pretty uneven in Pakistan. Punjab, of course, in many ways has a much better developed infrastructure. And I did want to make a comment on that when Nadia was talking about the donors. It is absolutely true. The donor contribution in terms of funding is only about a negligible 2% of all the education sector budgets. And yet it is spoken about a great deal more. But I do want to say that donor decisions are also sometimes dubious. For example, when DFID decided to go into Punjab and give huge, massive support to the provincial government of Punjab, it looked for the best opportunity of low-hanging fruit. It didn't go into Balochistan, which is really challenging. It did not go into Sindh, particularly into interior and remote areas of Sindh. It did not tackle the enormous issues that lie in the remote and internal parts of Khyber Pakhtunkhwa or in Fatah. So it went where it thought that there was a greater readiness for success. Now, I'm not necessarily challenging a particular strategy in that sense, because the strategic combination comes through both the federal, provincial, and the donor, the two governments and the donor agency. But I do think that the decision on where development partner funding should go should really rest on national priorities and national indications. And national indications really should be about the poorest, underserved areas. That's where the greatest need is. And it's not just the funding, it's also the technical assistance. And I think the valuable part of it is the technical assistance that comes to us through, whether it is through DFID or other development partners. So the debate around, just to get back quickly to your question, around the 18th Amendment is that it's an aspirational amendment, which is good. We are all committed to it. But on the ground, in reality, the 18th Amendment has not made a difference to how education is delivered at the provincial level.
I'd just like to point it to Dr. Ishrat. He wants to add a comment.
I think Shahnaz is absolutely right that the 18th Amendment has not made any significant difference because provinces were running. But what has made a significant difference is that the divisible tax pool under the 7th NFC award has now gone in favor of the provinces. They get 60% of the total resources compared to 40% for the federal government. So they are quite rich. Federal government has defense, debt servicing, and all the subsidies. So it's a very inflexible expenditure structure. While the provinces have three major responsibilities: law and order, education, and health. So they should be spending more with better governance. I accept this proposition that money is not the solution to the problem, but they should pay more attention to the devolution of education to the district governments and the local governments, and have the inspection and monitoring responsibilities at the provincial level, because that is the value for the money, which is not being realized today.
Nadia, I just, yes, you can add your comment to this, but I'll also add a question before that. In one of your pieces, there's this thing where you mentioned that of all the interventions that happen in Pakistan, some of them are, there are one or two that make some of the most differences, which is just making sure a teacher shows up at school. And so I'm just wondering, is like in the spread of current education provision, what are those, let's say, outsized determinants that actually make a difference to what schooling as it is currently being provided matters most?
Actually, I think that a lot has happened, a lot has changed, progress has been made in education, and this is the starting point. As in Punjab and KP, they will tell you two remarkable things. One, that over 90% of teachers are showing up in school. In Punjab, it's about, I think, 94%. In KP, it's about 87%. And this is where the absentee rates were about 20 to 30% of teachers were not showing up on any given day. And this has been brought down significantly. The interesting thing is that I think this is a big achievement in terms of the education system, but it still doesn't mean anything to parents. the you know parents still say, you know, school mein kuch hota nahi hai. You know, teachers there se aati hain, wo chai peeti hain, wo phir chali jaati hain. The kids tell you that, you know, teacher mujhse malish karwati thi. Or wo kulfi bolti thi kulfi khilao mujhe. And they will send them out of school to go get them lunch, and not through the door, but over the walls. And this is disregarding the risk of sexual abuse in schools, the common physical abuse in schools. So, you know, and these are things that finally, after all these years of DFID and, you know, the World Bank working on education in Pakistan and trying to lower this number of out-of-school children, which is the second highest in the world, have now come to say, maybe we need to change what's happening in schools in order for parents to put their kids in schools. This is how far we've come. And the problem is nobody knows exactly how to change what is happening inside of a school. This is the million-dollar question, and this is something that money doesn't fix. And I think this goes back, what we need is something that's very hard to concoct and really hard to buy, which is we need a vision for what education in this country should be, based on our idea of what a citizen of this country should be. That is how any other country in the world has achieved universal public schooling, and that's what we don't have. You know, you can look at Nawaz Sharif and say, where's the vision? What is your vision? We don't even have federal control over that vision. Everyone's going in their own direction with every government, every new, you know, ideological whim. So until we actually are interested enough to decide what we want the children of this country to be and actually be able to achieve in their lives, this question isn't going anywhere. That's how I see it.
Okay. Dr. Shahid, I just wanted to ask a question. Is we're in the second half, we're going to look into what sort of education system we need for what we need tomorrow in the coming future. But given our education system now, when we look at the kind of citizenship, the subjects of English, Urdu, civics, the civics components, the lessons that are inculcating, what is the citizen of today that it's creating in terms of its idealized version? What does it want? And what is that education system trying to do?
I think before answering your question, we need to look at the potential objectives of education. And when we talk of education, we think of development, we think of emancipation and freedom, and we think of freedom of expression and choice and you know, thought. But the kind of education we are giving in mainstream schools, that is based on transmission-based approach, which means that you know, the generation of teachers, they are trying to transmit or transfer the attitudes, skills, values of this generation to the next generation. And the assumption there is that the young generation are the children, students. They are empty vessels, are clean slates, and they are just at the receiving end. And our assessment system is totally memory-based, recall-based, which means that you know, the initial objective of emancipation, that is not there. The whole emphasis is on conformity. You know, whatever teacher tells you, you have to write that in the examination paper, otherwise you are going to fail. This is very important, and this means that our existing educational system lacks critical thinking and reflective practice. And ultimately, the outcome of this kind of system is that our graduates, they go to the society, they fill in the slots of job slots, but they're least bothered about what is happening in society, and they don't even think of challenging some of the taboos which are in this society. So I think this is our main challenge, that how we can produce independent thinkers, how we can produce people who are, you know, who have a very close liaison of what is going on in the society, and who at times should stand up and challenge some of the taboos of this society.
Okay. Dr. Ishrat, another question is, coming to the higher education space, we're seeing that the provinces are contesting that space. They've got their own higher education commissions. What has created this space for this alternate means, and should it actually be the one thing that remains at the federal level or not?
I think we are very good at creating adversarial positions and conflicts, rather than working together in a cooperative manner. There is a room for the Higher Education Commission at the center, which is to have the national standards and curriculum, which should be uniform across the country. So a degree from Balochistan should be acceptable to me at IBA as good as the degree from Punjab University. That is the role of the Higher Education Commission. But even under the present university acts and ordinances, the appointments of the vice chancellors, the selection of the teachers, the internal governance and management of these universities rests with the provincial governments. So rather than giving it to the provincial education departments, which are bureaucracies, you give these functions of what the provinces are doing already to the Provincial Higher Education Commission. So you can have a synergy between the federal and the provincial government. The funding still is coming mostly from the federal government. And the provincial governments can chip in and supplement where there are gaps. So it's a win-win situation if we work together. But unfortunately, we are very good at creating these kind of confrontations rather than trying to resolve the problems and fill in the gaps. So I'm in favor of both the Federal Higher Education Commission and the Provincial Higher Education Commission. We should work in sync with each other and try to fill in the existing weaknesses and the gaps.
But is that the case right now?
It's not the case. That's what I said. Yeah, yeah. Okay. We started with the wrong footing.
Yeah. Okay. Shahnaz, yes.
If I may just add a footnote to what Dr. Ishrat Husain has said, I think that there's also the underpinning of this architecture around higher education, which connects with the accreditation councils. So while there's the Higher Education Commission that lays down all sorts of regulation and guidelines for how universities are to be operated, but at the same time, if you want to establish any program, whether it is management sciences or engineering or social sciences or computer sciences, you have to abide by the requirements and the criteria that is established by the accreditation councils. And the accreditation councils come in and of course do a very, very thorough and a very intensive probe into a university before they give you accredit your programs. And the accreditation councils of course have the same standards that they apply across the country. And this is also, very rightly, as Dr. Ishrat has said, creating a conflict between the provincial higher education commissions and the accreditation councils. So the architecture of the higher education sector, I think, really needs to be looked at, and so that we don't at least destroy the effort that has been taking place and don't vitiate the standards, which I think at the higher education sector should definitely be at a national level across the country. The requirements for PhD cannot differ from province to province. The okay. requirements for research cannot differ from province to province. So there is a need to, I think, have that sort of discussion.
So Shahnaz, I wanted to ask a question, which was that our political system, at least in the past, was very heavily geared towards using the education system as a form of patronage. And we've seen how there have been mass scale teachers appointments, and we've seen how these particular jobs have been used. Has that changed, at least in some of the provinces? Has that recognition emerged, or is that incentivization still firmly in place?
No, I think that there has been a change there, definitely. I would say the Khyber Pakhtunkhwa government has worked very hard to bring about a recruitment process which is merit-based. So has Punjab. There have been significant improvements in the recruitment of teachers, because the teachers are the largest cohort that the government employs. Teachers across Pakistan run into more than 4 lakhs and 80,000, or close to 5 lakhs. And Sindh has also made an effort, so has Balochistan, but the merit-based recruitment policies are very much in place. I can't say that political patronage has been done away with completely, because, you know, we are part of a larger ecosystem, and there's political patronage everywhere. The education sector does not stand in a silo, And when we talk about universal rights, for example, to education, where is the universal access to good health care? Where is the universal access to clean drinking water? Where is universal access to minimal housing? And so on and so forth. But clearly the need for pressing increasingly for accountability of the education system is there. And that's what societal forums should be asking for all the time.
Nadia, just a question following up by what Dr. Shahid mentioned, which was that the education system's didactism creates a sort of closed mind. But in terms of the education system and the value sets that the public schooling is giving in terms of its curriculum, and when we look at education as a potential offset to an extremist narrative or whatever, is it actually managing to do that, or is it creating one subset of itself?
So when I spent 9 months looking at education, and I actually didn't look at curriculum. And that's because it's the one thing that most of us talk about when we talk about education. It's the one thing that you see a lot of op-eds about, extremist curriculums, etc. But when I looked at primary education, over half of your kids cannot read a sentence in Urdu, and 70% cannot write a sentence in Urdu. And this includes low-cost private schools. So for government schools, these numbers are even higher. So if your teachers who, you know, one I met was hired on the basis of merit, had a master's degree, was trained by USAID, was trained by Beacon House, and yet her third graders could not tell me the first letter in Pakistan. And other children, like I showed them a map of Pakistan from their books and they thought it was a mountain. So if that is what's, you know, if we're not achieving basic literacy for a child that's been in school for 5 years, I'm not really concerned with what else is in their books, because that's not translating to them in any way. What might concern me a little bit more is what that teacher is actually talking about in that classroom when he or she is talking. And I think that gets back to our vision question. Those teachers need to be inspired to teach and to lead and to be leaders. And to do that, our leaders need to be leaders. And that's something that I think is outside of our textbooks, actually. So our focus on what is on the page of a textbook, I think, is a little bit misplaced. And that question might also come in a bit more in secondary school. But 80% of our schools in Pakistan are primary schools. We don't even have secondary schools.
Okay, thank you. So Dr. Shahid, just a question. Is that we also have a multiplicity of systems at, you know, the primary, secondary, and that even politically we see talk of it contributing to a stratification, which already exists in society, but this is a structural means of just furthering that. So how much of a problem is that actually?
Thanks, but before I answer this question, I think I'll follow up what Nadia said, and I totally agree with her, because one school of thought look at curriculum as just a very cold document that every new government prepares and thinks that all the problems are solved. Prepare a new curriculum that talks against the terrorism. But I see curriculum as totally a different thing. I see curriculum as a kind of living interaction between teacher, students, and study materials. So this means that curriculum happens every moment in classroom. So no matter you prepare new curriculum or new books, unless the teacher who is actually executing that curriculum, if that is trained and if that is the change is there, no new curriculum can make any difference. So I think the key to this transformation is teachers. Your second question is very important. And since I've just finished this book, Education Policies, and I was looking at, there are a number of topics they discuss, but this question of inequality is totally missing. And ironically, education, which whose main function should be to bridge the socioeconomic gaps in society, education in Pakistan is further widening those gaps. I remember the times when there were schools and colleges where children of rich and poor, they would go to the same schools. But now there are separate schools for the rich people, and there are separate schools for those who cannot afford. The government schools are virtually depleted in terms of teachers and in terms of resources, and there is no accountability there. So it's unfortunate that education is not a license. It is not a guarantee that if you get a degree, you are going to get a job. Because remember one thing that when we talk of this power or capitals, there are three capitals Bourdieu talks about. Economic capital, that gives you power, and then this cultural capital and social capital. So if a student goes to a very elite school, not only he or she would get better teachers, but also the surrounding, the peers who belong to higher social network, this means his or her social capital is also up, which also means that a child has more life chances. So I think if we want to bring a change, we have to bring change at mainstream level. It's not that bringing change in ivory towers or some elite schools. But unless and until we address our public sector schools, our government schools, we cannot claim this change. And unfortunately, this inequality is on increase, and education ironically is instrumental in that inequality.
Okay. So I'm just going to ask everyone, if you have questions, if you just prepare them mentally. But before I allow you to ask the questions, just we're going to open the floor in 5 minutes. I'm going to ask our panel to quickly give maybe a quick impression of what they think the education system needs to imbibe in order for it to be relevant for tomorrow. And I'll open it with Dr. Ishrat, and if you could also just add some your perspective on higher education especially.
Yeah, I think because the 21st century is going to be a knowledge economy, we have to pay attention to prepare our students to shoulder those responsibilities in the generation, assimilation and dissemination of knowledge in various fields. That means that the link between the higher education, the secondary education and the primary education should be interlinked rather than very segmented and very separated. Now the science education should start right from the beginning because that lays the foundation. But the problem is that we are so much missing the basic ingredients. For example, you have a female science teacher getting her posting along with the post transferred to Quetta from Lorelei. So you have a surplus of science female teachers in Quetta, but you have a shortage in Avaran and Lorelei. And that is because we have a national pay scale. Unless you demolish the national pay scale and create a scarcity premium for the backward districts, both the inequality question as well as getting the people to study maths and science and other subjects which are very, very important for the future of the country, they will not be taken care of. The second point is have a clear division of responsibility between the various tiers of the government. A teacher from Jacobabad should not run to Karachi for his posting and transfer. Let the Jacobabad district government take care of all the primary to the metric education. They know it better. And bring in the NGOs or the private sector to administer the education board rather than have a bureaucrat running it. And finally, the whole Higher Education Commission and Provincial Education Commission, as Shahnaz rightly pointed out, we have to revisit the architecture and see how we can tweak it for the future generation.
Dr. Shahid?
Yeah, two things. I think we need to make a smart use of IT in terms of learning management system and campus management system. And second, I think we need to gear our whole education towards community service. Currently, I see that our universities and colleges, they are just working in isolation. The whole focus is on producing, churning out research papers and impact factor, all that. But I think the future is, in future, we need to be more more focused on community needs, what is happening in society and how our research can respond to those challenges. And finally, I think unless and until our education system focuses on creativity and innovation, this kind of education, no matter how much is our literacy, this system is not going to bring any qualitative change in society.
Okay. Nadia?
I don't think we're ready to talk about education. I think what we need to be talking about is literacy, which means the ability to read and also understand what you're reading. So the problem in a government school is that children are not literate in Urdu. Therefore, they don't understand what they're reading, so they memorize, and we have rote learning. The problem in low-cost private schools is that their books are in English. They don't understand English, and so they're rote learning. So I think until we achieve literacy, which also includes a child being able to understand the concepts that are in their books, then I don't think we can even talk about education.
Shahnaz?
I think we need to release the education system from a very heavy ideological dictation. The primary school curriculum should be on math, science, social sciences, and language. That's it. That's what the students need to know. They do not need to start with a detailed Pakistan studies from class 1 up to class 12, or Islamiyat from class 1 all the way through class 12. There needs to be a basic and fundamental grounding of core subject areas taught in the appropriate manner, appropriate age level, and in the right language. And by right language, I mean the language which is the mother tongue and native to the child. So the foundations for change in the education sector and then subsequently change in society will only come if on a scale we are able to change the public sector system to deliver education which is meaningful, relevant, and key areas of content and skill-based learning. If we can do that and then incorporate, of course, what I call, I think, very, very important part of the education cycle, which is the opportunity to be creative. And we have taken that completely out of the curriculum. So fundamental changes in curriculum are required. And of course, many changes, and I won't go through that, I think everybody knows. The corollary of well-trained teachers, closer oversight and monitoring, but fundamentally involvement of society. Those closest to the school are the ones that are most interested in the fact that the school should deliver well, that the teacher should be there. So although this reform took place some time ago with the parent-teacher committees that were formed, but not all of them are adequately functional. So the instruments for society to engage with the school have to be put in place, and they need to be given space, and the curriculum needs a complete revisiting.
Okay. So I'll open up the floor to questions, and I'd request everyone to ask very brief questions so that we can have them answered. So I remember, yes, you can ask your question. Yes. If you could hand a mic. Yes. If you could just give us your name and...
My name is Akram, and I would like to appreciate first the very wonderful and intellectual discourse happened here. My question is to Dr. Shahid Siddiqui Saab and Dr. Ishrat, both are very distinguished educationists of Pakistan. Since inception of Pakistan, we saw and we have been witnessing the three sort of education systems. One is the elite education system, and the public sector education, and mother's education. So we have seen the two sectors have a progress will be and phenomenally developed. One is the mother's education. Recently, according to some authentic reports, 35,000 mothers are existing in the Pakistan, as well as the private education, as a few distinguished mentioned, have touch the skies, and certain privileged classes are going to be educated. What about the public sector education? What are the main reasons that has bitterly failed, has not delivered the good education to the major chunk of the children of the people of Pakistan?
Thank you. All right.
This is my fundamental.
All right, thank you. We'll ask a second question, and then I'll ask the panel And then we'll follow up with the third back there. Yes, your question.
Thank you. My name is Sufia Mumtaz. I'm a social anthropologist. And most of the points that I had in mind have been addressed. But I would like to know at the policy formulation level, what exactly is happening to address the inequality in education, the content of the education, the caliber of the teachers, and even the creativity, which I think is extremely important, okay. The holism that is absent in curriculum in terms of the social sciences, the arts, literature, etc., etc., and actually also the value that is placed on the status and salaries of teachers, which would be an incentive to ensure that the teachers have to be capable of delivering before they're allowed to given a job.
Yes, if we could pass the mic over there. If you could please ask your question quickly, over there, back there. Yes, that one.
My name is Shahira. My question is probably directed to Dr. Ishrat. While Nadia, you know, shifted the focus from the need to see what's happening in the curriculum, I guess we all can agree with what happened in Maidan 2 days back with the student. It's thrown into limelight the need to revisit the curriculum. Very quickly, where are we in terms of pushing for a liberal core, a liberal curriculum when it comes to higher education, which is something I've seen vigorously happening at Habib University only thus far?
Okay, so we'll answer these questions, and then if we have time, we'll move for a second round of questions. So the first question was that we've seen a substantial growth both in madrasas, and we've seen it happen in the private sector. Why is the education sector not moving as fast or as well as these sectors?
Okay. The first, let me get the facts right. Out of 100% of enrollment at the primary school level and the secondary level, the enrollment in madrasa is only 5%. So it's not that great. It's 95% is private and public. So it's highly exaggerated, and therefore this does not reflect the facts. Second point is, for education where we are lagging behind all our neighboring countries, as far as both the enrollment ratios are concerned, as well as the adult literacy rate, all hands on the deck approach is going to take us. Whether it is the non-governmental organization, it is a private sector, it is the public sector, we all have to work together in order to raise both our enrollment literacy rates and the quality of education. And if the private sector is coming in the picture, so be it, I welcome that. There should not be an ideological distinction that this is, yes, the government's responsibility is right to education, because that's now a constitutional right. Whether it is delivered by government or it is delivered by somebody else, but it is financed by government, that's perfectly legitimate. The question which you had raised, you may not know, but a business school like IBA today has a very robust undergraduate degree program in social sciences and liberal arts, where there are 20 PhDs from all over the world in sociology, anthropology, political science, international relations, psychology, media studies, and the curriculum is very, very liberal in order to meet the demands of our society. I personally do not think that Pakistan's societal problems can be handled by going and doing PhD in the universities abroad. They can be done by our own scholars in Pakistan, because we have a laboratory around our own campuses. We can do the experiments, we can do the research here, and the payoff will be much greater than if you just spend 6 years doing it at Berkeley or Northwestern.
Yes, Dr. Shahid.
Okay, I'll go to the second question, policies. You talked about what government is doing about policies, but my view is totally different, because we have wonderful policies in this country, right from 1947 up to 2009. But when it comes to implementation, all the education policies failed.
Right.
And I don't know, maybe it's lack of political will, lack of consistency, and lack of accountability. But the fact is that recently, as I said, I finished this book, and I saw that we had wonderful policies, but there was no implementation at all. So I don't know that we should attach lots of expectations with a new policy as well.
Okay. So I'll open it up again for questions.
Sorry.
Yes?
Just if I may.
Please.
There was a question here about salaries of teachers and what can incentivize teachers. There has been a sea change in government sector salaries of teachers at the primary school level. And a teacher that used to draw 10, 12,000 rupees is today drawing between 30 and 40 and 50,000 rupees. A headmaster of a secondary school with 8 or 10 years of experience is now drawing something in the range of 85,000 to 95,000 rupees in public sector schools. So that difference has taken place. And but just paying the same person a higher salary does not necessarily mean that that person is going to become a more effective teacher. But some incentives have definitely been put in place and across Pakistan by all the provinces.
Can I just add to that real quick? Fasi?
Yes, please add. We'll just hand the mic over to them, but he'll wait for you.
No, and next to what Shahnaz just said, a private school teacher in this country is paid about
5,000
rupees a month. 5,000 rupees a month. But those teachers are producing kids who are two grades ahead of the ones in the public sector. The public sector is spending about 1,800 rupees per child, and the private sector is probably spending on average less than half of that. So, you know, the salary question doesn't really translate.
Okay, I'm gonna pass on the question to you, and then if you could hand the mic over to the lady in green. But please, very quick questions, we have very little time. Yes.
میں اردو میں بات کروں گا آزاد کشمیر کے سب سے پسماندہ علاقے میں میں 20-30 سال سے پڑھا رہا ہوں ان کمزور بچوں اور ان کے والدین کے درمیان مجھے پتہ ہے کیا گزر رہی ہے ان پر اور تجاویز سب کے پاس ہیں بہت اچھی عمل کرنے کا اختیار سب کے پاس نہیں ہے جو مختصر راستہ ہے آپ گاؤں والوں پہ اعتماد کریں حکومت اپنے حصے کے پیسے ان کو دے اور ان کو چھوڑ دے آپ ان پہ اعتماد کرنا سیکھیں غلامی کے دور سے ہم نے اب کبھی اپنی عوام پہ اعتماد کرنا نہیں سیکھا ہم چاہتے ہیں کہ وہ سیکھیں جس طرح ہم انہیں سکھانا چاہتے ہیں اختیار نیچے نہیں دیں گے تو پیٹتے رہیں سر انگریزی پشتو اردو جس میں مرضی نیچے اختیار دے پیسے ان کے حصے کے گاؤں والا اپنے بچے کے لیے سب سے بہتر فیصلے کرنا جانتا ہے شکریہ
بہت مہربانی تھینک یو سو مچ دیٹ از بیوٹیفلی سیڈ یس
جی ایز سم ون ہوز ورکڈ آن دا امپلیمنٹیشن آف دا نیشنل کریکولم فار 5 years میں ایک بہت ریسپیکٹڈ پینل ہے لیکن میں یہ پوائنٹ آؤٹ کرنا چاہتی ہوں کہ اگر کریکولم اٹ سیلف کو دیکھا ہو ہم لوگوں نے تو اس میں یہ ساری چیزیں آلریڈی موجود ہیں جو سائنس کریکولم ہے اس میں لکھا ہے کہ بچے سیکھیں کہ وہ پرابلم سالونگ کریں آبزرویشن کریں کریٹیکل تھنکنگ کریں جو انگلش کا کریکولم ہے اس میں 5 میں سے 1 کمپیٹنسی اس متعلق ہے کہ بچے ٹالرنٹ ہوں گلوبل سٹیزنس کی طرح سوچیں ایٹسیٹرا سو اٹس ناٹ بینگ امپلیمنٹڈ سو مے بی وی شوڈن یوز دا ورڈ کریکولم سو لوزلی اینڈ دا کریکولم از بیوٹیفلی میڈ دا ویژن از دیئر It just needs to be implemented.
Yes. I'll just ask you, yes. But quick question. Yes.
My question is, anyway, I speak quite loudly. My question is, why don't we talk about the population explosion and education? I mean, whatever we offer in terms of schools, everything is diluted because of the population explosion. And I also know that if a girl, it says Pakistani statistics, if a Pakistani girl studies up to matriculation, she'll not have more than 4 children. So, and when she goes up to grade 12, she'll not have more than 3. And later, and BA, she won't have more than 2. So All why right. don't we combine these two? And in Pakistan, we are not talking about population explosion at all. This is one of the major challenges which we have. And another thing which Sir, Professor Shahid said, that in the curriculum, and this child also has said the same, everything is there, but it all depends on the teacher, how she is going to translate those attitudes and bring about attitudinal and behavioral changes and citizenship. And sir, one thing which I would like to point out to you is that the elite schools, let's not say that they are teaching citizenship, they are breeding another type of elite
altogether where it's just the privileged and it's their rights and responsibilities they're aware of. They are not aware of what they should do as citizens.
Okay, thank you very much. Now, I'm just going to, you wanted to make a comment and then I'll pass it to you, Shahnaz, and then we'll conclude the session. Yeah.
I think what someone said, a person who talked about curriculum, I think that that's exactly what I was trying to communicate, that that is a very different kind of definition of curriculum. You said that we have made curriculum. I'm saying that that is not curriculum. The real curriculum happens in classroom. That is interaction of teacher with students, with study materials, right? So when we talk of curriculum, we, normally we ignore the execution of curriculum. The complete package comes with actual execution of curriculum. That execution is not there. And that is why I said the key, if we want to bring a qualitative change, is the teacher. And we need to have some qualitative teacher training programs. Unfortunately, most of the teacher training programs in Pakistan, they focus on just skills, pedagogies, strategies. But I think we need to focus at three levels: the conceptual change of teachers, the pedagogical change, and the attitudinal change. Only then we'll have a holistic approach towards change. Thank you.
Okay, Shahnaz, very quickly, please.
جی میرے خیال میں آزاد جموں کشمیر سے جو آپ میرے بھائی نے بات کی ہے وہ بالکل درست ہے اختیارات کی منتقلی جو مرکز نے صوبوں کو دی ہے صوبوں کو ڈسٹرکٹس کو دینی چاہیے اور یہ بالکل لازم ہے کہ ڈسٹرکٹس کو بالکل لوئسٹ یونٹ کو دینی چاہیے تاکہ اسکول بیسڈ جو مانیٹرنگ ہے اسکول بیسڈ اونرشپ ہے وہ ان کے پاس ہو تو اسکول مینجمنٹ کمیٹیز کے جو بجٹس ہیں وہ بہت ہی محدود ہیں ان کو زیادہ بڑھانے کی ضرورت ہے یہی طریقہ ہے اور کوئی طریقہ نہیں ہے پوری دنیا میں چینج جو ہے یا کلوزسٹ ٹو دا اسکول لیول ہوتا ہے اور وہ چینج ہوتا ہے تھرو سوسائٹیز انٹریکشن پیرنٹل انٹریکشن تو آپ کی بات بالکل درست ہے اور اس کے لیے میرا خیال ہمیں بار بار مطالبہ بھی کرنا چاہیے
quickly pass it on now.
Sure.
We're just
on
ending.
Curriculum, yes. I just wanted to say that my point on curriculum was that it's an overloaded curriculum for the pre-primary and primary children. And that's why you're getting poor learning outcomes. A curriculum that is overly packed, overly crammed, is not going to produce good learning outcomes.
Nadia, very quickly.
So I just want to point out, we have a huge blind spot in the way that we're looking at education. We're famous for 22 million out-of-school kids. Everyone knows that number. But only 5 million of these kids are 9 and younger, meaning those 5 million you can take and put them into a primary school. The rest of the 22 million, which is about 17 million, are 10 and over. You can't put a 14-year-old into Kachi or grade 1, and they will drop out. We need accelerated programs. We need programs that can take an older child who wants to go to school and get them into the right grade level quickly. Nobody is talking about this at all. So our broken promises are still broken. We're not even asking the right questions.
So I'd like to thank Nadia, Shahnaz, Dr. Ishrat, Dr. Shahid for being on the panel. It's a bit difficult to summarize what we've discussed, but essentially there's a complexity of issues that still exist. We're looking at things like the formalized aspects of what constitute a system, but we're seeing that, you know, the components on what is a teacher saying in the classroom, what kind of learning is happening, what we're looking for in the future, that the challenges are still immense, things that we have to look at. Maybe some of the questions around, say, extremism and a number of other things are too simplified, but even structural issues that still need to be resolved, like, you know, our friend from Azad Kashmir, like what was spoken about the Higher Education Commission. I do think we're probably in a better place. I remember, just a quick nugget, there was a famous story in education circles in the 1980s, I presume false, but about a minister in Zia's cabinet who went to the UK to study the English education system so that he could learn and put some things in place in Pakistan. And when he came back, they asked him, so what do you want to change? And he says, bahut mushkil hai. Un tak pahunchna bahut mushkil hai. Khud ye log itna tarakki kar rahe hain, England ka to bacha bacha angrezi bolta hai. So this idea of, you know, some of our confused priorities on what constitutes inputs and what create benefits, I think there's things that are still needed in this debate. And I'd like to thank all of you for attending, and I'd like to thank our panel for being a part of it. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you for attending this session. Our next session is a book launch, How Pakistan Got Divided, by Major General Retired Rao Farman Ali.